Take a look at this picture. What do you think it's showing? It may look abstract and formless, but it's actually a man and woman dancing. Now take a look at this. This may similarly appear to be nothing in particular, but it's a man riding a horse. There's a fascinating article on context.org written by Robert Gilman, and this article includes an interview with a biologist named Rupert Sheldrake. He explains an experiment he did that yielded very interesting results. The experiment begins by showing these pictures to a group of test subjects to establish a baseline for how easily the picture can be recognized. Then, on TV, so you can reach a large number of people, you explain how to identify the hidden image in one of these pictures. Lastly, you find a group of test subjects who haven't seen or heard about the TV show, and test their ability to recognize the hidden image. The experimental question is, if lots of people learn to spot the hidden image in the puzzle picture, will it be easier for other, unrelated people to spot it as well? The first TV experiment was done in Britain in 1983 with 2 million viewers. Several thousand people were then tested in different parts of the world, and the result was positive for the theory. The percentage recognizing the hidden image shown on television increased after this broadcast, whereas the percentage recognizing the control picture, the one that wasn't shown on TV, didn't change. There were two more experiments conducted later that yielded similar results. There's another experiment that's relevant involving rats. The experiment included teaching rats to run a particular maze. Each new generation of rats learned it faster, even though there was no direct physical way for any generation to pass its learning on to the next. You see, Rupert Sheldrake has this theory about morphic fields. To quote Sheldrake from an article he wrote for his website, they contain a built-in memory, given by self-resonance with a morphic unit's own past and by morphic resonance with all previous similar systems. This memory is cumulative. The more often particular patterns of activity are repeated, the more habitual they tend to become. His theory involves these invisible fields that receive and transmit data involving living beings. His explanation for the experiment he conducted is that, once many people, or animals, are aware of the solution to a problem, others will intrinsically be able to solve that same problem. Needless to say, the idea of morphic resonance is a bold one, one that has had its share of criticism.
In practice, if book burning were allowed, this book would be a candidate.
But the results of these experiments should be viewed not as concrete proof of the concepts, but as enough reason to not immediately disregard morphic fields as pseudoscience. So maybe the important question is not, is Sheldrake's theory to be believed? But rather, who cares? Why are you telling me about this? There's a game for the DS called 9 Hours, 9 Persons, 9 Doors. 9 people are kidnapped on a ship by someone named Zero, and they have to work together to solve escape room-like puzzles to leave the ship before their 9-hour deadline expires and the ship sinks. There are 9 doors that have the aforementioned puzzles behind them, and each room has a number 1 through 9 on it. Only 3 to 5 people can enter a room. Each person is assigned a number on a bracelet they wear. The people that enter any of the doors with the number must have a combined digital route that equals the number on the door. The door that leads to the second-class cabin has a 4 on it. So Junpei, Lotus, June, and Santa enter. Their bracelets have 5, 8, 6, and 3 on them. These numbers added together equal 22, and if you add the 10's digit and 1's digit, you get a 1-digit number, 4. The reason I'm explaining all this is to show you the limitations put on these 9 players. They can't all enter the same door, and the composition of people who enter any given door is specific. All of this digital route business leads to a few key points later on in the story that make the game very interesting. But for now, just know that certain people can enter doors if their numbers align, so to speak. All of this stuff orchestrated by Zero is referred to as the Nonary Game, and it only gets more interesting from there. The 9 main characters are based on the 9 groups in the Enneagram of Personalities. Since all of the characters are archetypes of their respective group, naturally, disputes arise. The tension of being on a ship with a time bomb ticking down is only exasperated when the people involved get into disagreements. Usually because Lotus said something stupid. I freaking hate her. I'm bringing this game up for a reason. It connects heavily to Sheldrake's theory. The inspiration for the story occurred when Kotaro Uchikoshi, the director and writer, asked, "Where do mankind's inspirations come from?" Starting from there and reading all kinds of documents led him to discover Sheldrake's theory on the morphogenetic field. This game is a visual novel, so naturally you'll be seeing a lot of text, but when you're not reading, you'll be solving the escape rooms I mentioned earlier. These puzzles are enjoyable on their own merits, but the best thing about this game is how greatly they contribute to the game's atmosphere and overarching messages. The puzzles sort of play like a point-and-click adventure game, where you select different parts of the screen to investigate it. Doing this can lead to you discovering items, some of which can be combined with other items to make new ones, and these items can be used to help find a way out of the rooms you find yourself in. However, the most notable part of these rooms is, surprisingly enough, not the puzzle solving. Earlier, I mentioned the non-eerie game's restraints on how many people and who specifically can enter an escape room. You play as Junpei, who has the number 5 on his bracelet, and there are multiple situations where you get to pick the room you enter. Since every room has a different number on it, the same group can't enter two different rooms. The first choice you get is at the beginning of the game. As I've said, you can either go through room 4 with Lotus, June, and Santa, or you can opt to go through room 5 with Snake and 7. When you're solving these escape rooms, the characters present will have conversations with each other, sometimes about the puzzles you're solving, and other times about unrelated topics. My point is that although the main focus of this room is to solve puzzles, the conversations that occur in these rooms are paramount to what makes this game so great. And depending on the decisions you make, you'll be in different rooms with different people, observing different conversations about different topics. The stuff you'll read can range from a sentence-long quip to a lengthy explanation of a psychological topic or urban legend. Firstly, these are just good for the game's pacing. None of the characters are particularly annoying, except Lotus, so hearing what they have to say breaks up what are considerably long sections of logic and puzzle solving. Beyond pacing, these conversations serve a very important role. You see, 999 presents itself as a mystery game where you try to figure out how you got on this boat, who Zero is, and the explanation to all the other strange happenings that occur. However, 999 spins a basic mystery plot into something much more unique with its subtle integration of scientific elements into its storytelling. In the second-class cabin, the only way to escape is to find a key with the Mars symbol on it. You collect these four pieces of a picture in the cabin, and when you arrange them to assemble a picture, it reveals the alcove where the key is hidden. If you look at this picture, you notice it's all blobby and abstract, bearing an obvious resemblance to the experiments conducted by Sheldrake. Santa wonders aloud what this picture is, and Lotus proceeds to explain a very familiar scenario. She mentions a book she read by a British biochemist named Sheldrake. She describes an experiment very similar to the one that actually occurred, attributing its effects to a field not visible to the eye, even mentioning the morphogenetic field and morphic resonance by name, likening them to the concept of telepathy. After laying out the facts, everyone dismisses these studies as probably just pseudoscience, with some clear level of uncertainty. The group proceeds to leave the room and move on. In the steam engine room, Santa explains that the power of morphic resonance is compounded when a subject is put in danger, even directly referencing the real-life rat experiment I mentioned. I'll elaborate on the main role of morphic resonance in 999 later, but there are examples of stuff like this all over the game. You might think the sudden mention of a topic like this is distracting or poorly written, but in practice, it's very well executed. Most of the game is very tense, and mentioning such strange phenomena adds to this mood in no small part. You've probably noticed this game's attraction to the number 9. I mean, it's literally called 999. They keep this trend up with the frequent mention of a card game called Baccarat. Santa mentions this game in the second class cabin, and Lotus points out its similarities to the non-eerie game they're playing. In the casino, Seven explains the rules of Baccarat to Junpei, and you even have to play a minigame similar to Baccarat to proceed through the room. Baccarat involves gambling on the banker or player, guessing who will win. You add up all the values of the cards, drop the tens digit, and whoever has the number closest to 9 is the winner. Seven mentions that the strongest hand is a 9. This is an interesting thing for him to mention, because the number 9 bracelet is the most potent, because it can be added to any team without changing the digital route, a clear parallel being pointed out. Additionally, Santa mentions that getting a hand of 9 in Baccarat is called La Grande, because you can't lose. Similarly, to win the non-eerie game, you have to find the door with a 9 on it to escape. Getting a 9 in either game spells victory. There's also frequent mention of the Titanic. There's a picture in the cabin Junpei wakes up in that very closely resembles the famous ship. Zero mentions it seemingly out of nowhere when communicating to the group for the first time over a speaker. In the second class cabin, Junpei and June discuss the Titanic's sister ship named the Olympic, and the possibility that they're on the actual Titanic. June mentions multiple books that predict the sinking of the Titanic with eerie accuracy. The central staircase on the boat bears a striking resemblance to the grand staircase on the real Titanic. The obvious similarity that the Titanic sunk and the boat the game takes place on is set to sink, you get the point. The setting of 999's resemblance to the Titanic both physically and conceptually is certainly ominous, and this similarity has importance later on in the story. I could go on forever about this stuff, like the game's mention of Ice 9 and ice that's solid at room temperature, based off of the substance in the book Cat's Cradle, which itself is based off of the real polymorph named Ice 9, Or I could talk about the astrological references on the many keys and locks throughout the game, or how ethylene diamine tartrate suddenly hydrated in a factory and caused every other EDT crystal to follow suit, as if some sort of field was allowing them to communicate. Or the urban legend of Priestess Amun-Ra being transported on the Titanic. Or the mention of the philosophical paradoxes called Locke's socks and Theseus's ship, but I think you get the point I'm making. All these biological and philosophical concepts are great on their own, and serve a purpose, but really their biggest role is towards the end of the game. To fully elaborate on the best part of this game, I'll need to mention the ending, so if you'd like to avoid spoilers, skip to the timestamp on screen. Let me give you a rundown on the plot of 999. It's slowly and subtly revealed to you that, 9 years ago, a group called Cradle Pharmaceutical put 9 children on the Gigantic, a replica of the Titanic, and 9 children in Building Q in Nevada. The building had an identical interior to the ship. The children inside the ship were forced to solve puzzles or sink alongside the ship, similar to the non-airy game that you spend most of the game playing through. The idea was for the children in Building Q to transmit the solutions to the puzzles to the children on the boat. The purpose of this experiment was to test the concept of the morphogenetic field. Everyone in the second non-airy game is related to the first one in some way. The ninth man and Ace helped organize it. Seven was a police officer investigating the kidnapped children, Lotus is the parent of twins who were used in the experiment, and everyone else except Junpei were the test subjects of the first non-airy game. I'll get to Junpei's role in the first non-airy game in a bit, but let me talk about one of the most important characters, June. Junpei is unaware of the first non-airy game at the beginning of 999 until he eventually finds out some details from other characters, like when Seven gets his memory back. Junpei learns that a girl named Akane Kurashiki was burned to death 9 years ago, and is unsettled by this because June's real name is Akane Kurashiki. 9 years ago, when Seven was escorting the children off the ship, Ace grabbed Akane and threatened to incinerate her if she didn't solve a puzzle, presumably in a last-ditch effort to test the effects of morphic resonance. Akane uses the morphogenetic field to contact Junpei 9 years in the future to help him solve the puzzle at the end of the game. Junpei's role in the first non-airy game doesn't happen until 9 years after, when he communicates with Akane from the past. In the DS version of the game, the text through the entire game on the bottom screen is Akane's perception of the events occurring, and similarly, towards the end of the game, the top screen displays the present and the bottom screen displays the past and the events that Akane experienced 9 years ago. And the puzzle Akane had to solve to escape was Sudoku, the game with 9 rows, 9 columns, and 9 boxes. It doesn't stop there, though. There's 6 endings to this game, and you have to get at least one of the endings before you can get the true ending that reveals everything. The ending you get depends on the doors you choose to enter and some of the dialogue choices you make. Replaying 999 in a New Game Plus-esque way actually makes narrative sense because it's Akane showing Junpei the different possible outcomes and relaying key information to him. In one of the paths you can take, you discover a piece of paper that contains a riddle to display a code on a player's bracelet, and that code can be used to unlock a safe. This same code is also used to unlock the coffin in the chapel. The interesting thing is, it's impossible to find the piece of paper with the riddle on it and go to the chapel in the same path. But if you find the paper, then in a new playthrough, follow the path that leads to the chapel, Junpei will remember the riddle and be able to unlock the coffin, even though he never found the paper in that timeline. It's almost as if Akane was able to transmit the solution to the coffin puzzle through a field unseen to the eye. There are other examples of information carrying on throughout different playthroughs as well, like Junpei discovering Ace has prosopagnosia and putting that to use in a different ending. 9 Hours, 9 Persons, 9 Doors is unlike any other game, let alone any other visual novel. Its reference to real-world concepts, some you'll be familiar with and others likely not, is done in the best way possible. Their mention is bizarre and perfectly fits the mystery story that takes place, but more than anything, it's genius how every weird story about a pair of socks or some weird crystals culminates into an unforgettable ending. It very naturally eases you into the massive story it has to tell, and you're never left bored waiting for the plot to wrap up because you always have these little tidbits and anecdotes to ponder on, wondering what their larger purpose is or just to reflect on the absurdity of what they're saying. Everything I've talked about so far is just one aspect of the storytelling. I haven't even mentioned all of the quirks this game has that I adore, like a blind main character, or a tense soundtrack, or a lot of plot twists that I haven't even mentioned. Oscar Wilde wrote an essay in 1889 called The Decay of Living. It states that, "Life imitates art far more than art imitates life. However, if art were to imitate life, a plot where 9 starkly different personalities are forced to work together on a Titanic replica would be a good place to start." And Oscar Wilde, let me say I cannot agree more. 999 only sold about 40,000 copies upon release in Japan, but its localization to North America garnered a lot of well-deserved praise from reviewers. Heavily implementing ideas from reality into fiction is risky business, because it can lead to sloppy storytelling and lost immersion, but 9 hours, 9 persons, 9 doors will have you thinking that just maybe, a story as mind-boggling and unexpected as this one could really happen.